questions. What can I do to recognize and reduce the risk of elder financial exploitation? How can I guard against identity theft? What plan should I make in advance to plan for managing my finances if I'm not able to do so? And then how can I prepare financially for what tomorrow may bring? All very important topics and questions that we're finding with our older clients. So, what is elder exploitation or financial exploitation? The Older American Act defines this as financial exploitation as the fraudulent or otherwise illegal, unauthorized or improper actions by a caregiver, fiduciary, or other individual in which the resources of an older person are used by another for a personal gain or profit, or actions that result in depriving an older person of the benefits, resources, belongings, or assets into which they are entitled. So, when we talk about some of these things, why do we focus on our elder clients or our elder community? Part of the reason is typically they have larger assets, have more resources than our younger clients. Oftentimes we're more trusting. Am I loud enough? No? Okay.
No. Let me get the microphone, because then you can see off of that TV.
No,
they're not seeing.
Yeah, they're not seeing. Could I be a little closer?
Sure. All right, is that better? All right, sorry about that. So we were talking about financial exploitation with our older clients and our older people in our communities. And I do want to preface this by saying anybody can be a victim of financial exploitation. It's not just our older community. It crosses all social, educational, economic boundaries. Older people are just at a higher risk of falling victim. Again, we talked about reasons why. Larger assets, a lot of our younger folks don't have a lot of cash, don't have a lot of investments, whereas our older clients and community do. Maybe trusting, or maybe reluctant to call out somebody who they think may be frauding them. Maybe vulnerable because of loneliness, social isolation, or grieving. Could be receiving care from a person that has substance abuse issues, gambling problems. Also fear retaliation. You know, if I tell on this person, are they going to come back and hurt me? Maybe unfamiliar with managing financial matters. Also could be unprepared for retirement and the potential loss of financial decision-making capacity. May have cognitive impairments that affect their financial decision-making. Or they could be dependent on a family member or a caregiver to take care of them. You know, keeping up their home, transporting them to the doctor's office. So there are a lot of reasons why we may come across that. So, the question we ask then, who can we trust? As we stated, you have to be very cautious of who you do trust to help you with your financial situation. One of your best safeguards is to be aware, alert, and talk to someone you do trust before making any financial decisions. So maybe a family member, a child, a spouse. Maybe an attorney, somebody that you've worked with that you do trust. Some of the reasons older Americans may not report financial exploitation, they may be embarrassed. They may have loyalty to the person who's exploiting them. They may, fear retaliation, dependence on that person. Maybe they just don't believe it's happening, you know, denial. Self-blame, maybe it's partly my fault. That could be a reason, or just overall lack of awareness. Now, you have a handout that you can reference that will give you some tips and things that you can do if you feel like you are a victim of financial exploitation, or if you know somebody that you feel could be a victim. You can take that home with you. Next, we'll talk a little bit about power of attorney. Oops. Okay. As everybody knows, power of attorney is when you give somebody the authority to act on your behalf financially in your stead. So if for some reason you can't act on your behalf, I always recommend everybody should have a power of attorney. If you live alone, you know, regardless of age. I have power of attorney for my parents. My husband has power of attorney for me. So regardless of age, it's just good to have a backup, have somebody who can act on your behalf financially if you can't. That happens a lot, unfortunately. So we remind people, choose somebody that you trust. You know, whether it's a family member, a lifelong friend, you know, it can be a fiduciary through a bank. They can act as that as well. Be cautious when you're picking a power of attorney and make sure that it's not somebody who's pressuring you into choosing them, pressuring you to make certain financial decisions. It can be revoked. So if you've set somebody up as power of attorney and you have some concerns, that is definitely an option that you have. You can remove the power of attorney or take that power away. So something that's good for people to know. Also, choose caregivers or in-home helpers that you can trust. I know a lot of people, myself included, I have a disabled daughter and we have in-home care for her. And through the years, we've had people in the home that, you know, probably shouldn't have been in our home. And, you know, had I given it more thought or, you know, thought more about it, I probably would have been more cautious. But if you have somebody who's not a family member, somebody that's coming from an agency, somebody that you've hired, make sure you keep your valuables in a safe place, whether in a lockbox, a safe deposit box at the bank. Secure your private documents, statements, social security number. All of those things should be kept locked up. Require receipts for purchases made by helpers. So if you're sending your helper to do your grocery shopping, make sure you get a receipt and keep those receipts. Monitor your bank statements and your phone bills to make sure they're not making long distance calls on your dime. They're not using your bank account in a way that they shouldn't be. Consider setting up transaction alerts. So most banks offer an alert. So if there's a large withdrawal made from your account, maybe you or a family member gets an automatic alert that's immediate so that you know something is going on that you need to be aware of. Do not let hired caregivers or helpers open your mail, pay your bills, or manage your finances. I mean, that's just a good best practice because, you know, sometimes these people will get desperate and, you know, that's one way they may choose to go. Never promise money or assets to someone when you pass away in exchange for care provided now. You know, these people are doing a job. They're not necessarily here to become your best friend. Never lend employees money or personal property. Never let caregivers use your credit or debit cards to run errands or make purchases for you. Again, in some cases, I know that that's typical or that's, you know, normal business. If that is the case, again, make sure this is somebody you trust and that you're getting receipts. So now let's talk a little bit about how to avoid identity theft. And for anybody that does not know, identity theft is when somebody takes on your identity with your name, date of birth, social security number, and typically, receives credit or sets up credit in your name, and the point is to defraud you. And as bankers, we can tell you right now, we see this all the time. So it's a big deal. I'd like to come back and do a presentation just on that because we're just going to skim across this pretty quickly. But protect your personal information. So these are things that you can do to help protect yourself from becoming a victim. Like I said before, protect your numbers. Keep things locked up. If you've got a locked desk, if you've got you know, a file cabinet, if you've got a little safe at home, keep all your important numbers in there. Date of birth, social security number, anything that somebody could use to become you, essentially on paper. Protect your mail. For incoming mail, get a locked mailbox. I know we have seen rashes in the past, especially in Lafayette. We've seen where, you know, mailboxes were disturbed, people, fraudulent people were going through and taking out people's statements. We're getting their information that way. And when you're mailing bills or anything that's got a check, anything that's got your checking account information, drop it off in the post office box rather than putting it in your own mail. Because there are people that go around, go through mailboxes, take out anything that looks like it would have information on it. And if you think about it, a check's got your name, it's got your address, it's got the routing number for the bank, and it's got your account number. So, you know, just another thing that you can do to help protect yourself. Set your income up for direct deposit. So don't be receiving checks through the mail as much as possible. You know, if you don't have your pension, Social Security, any income that you receive coming through direct deposit, get that set up. It's just one last check that'll be sitting in your mailbox. Clean up your trash, or your financial trash. If you don't have a shredder, I suggest investing in one. You can buy really inexpensive ones, $35-$40, and I always recommend the cross shred. That really, really chops that mail up good. So, you know, any statements or anything, because there are people that dumpster dive. And again, you know, it's a lot of things that we don't think about. I probably never would have thought about that myself if I hadn't had the training. So, you know, just something to be cautious of. Watch your statements and your bills. You know, look at your bank statement every month. Look through there. Is there anything that I don't recognize? Is there a large withdrawal? Is there, you know, a check that cleared that was not made payable or that I didn't sign? Just looking at all your bills, credit card bills, maybe did I not make that purchase? And if you find that there's something that you don't recognize, contact that company immediately. Let them know, this was not me. Most banks, most companies have a process in place to take care of fraud. And then also be cautious on the internet. Never provide your information, like if you receive an email or a text or even a phone call. They call and ask you, you know, oh, I need your information really quick. There's something wrong with your computer. We need to get the bug off of there. Give me your account number. Those are all scams, and a lot of that does come through the internet. You know, installing a free or low-cost firewall to stop intruders from gaining remote access to your computer might be a good idea. You know, if it's something that you don't know how to set up, proactively go to somebody who can. Don't rely on somebody coming to you, because that's where we see a lot of the fraud. And then the last thing around identity theft, review your credit regularly. You can go into annualcreditreport.com up to 3 times a year, and it's free. It doesn't affect your credit if you're looking at it yourself, but you can take a look at all 3 of the different bureaus, Equifax, Experian, and TransUnion. You can look to see if there's anything unusual. You know, maybe there's a new account that showed up that you didn't open, then you know there may be an issue. And within the documents that we handed out, there's all kinds of instructions on who to call, what department, you know, if you feel like something is just out of the ordinary, not what you were expecting. Now I'm going to turn it over to Courtney.
You actually just call them, or you can contact them. Like, they all have 3 websites that actually will link you through annualcreditreport.com, or you can go there directly and you can actually freeze and unfreeze it online, or you can call. Because we've done applications for people that forget they've frozen it, and then they have 24 hours from our application to go on and get that unfrozen, and then the underwriters can actually look at it. So it's not the end of the world if you forget that it's frozen, but it does protect you. Like, for my young daughters, they're not going to get credit for till they're 18, obviously. I have theirs frozen right now just in case somebody would try to steal their social security number. So it's just a good practice.
How long does it take, like, from when you start to get it frozen and then to unfreeze it?
Like I said, we only have 24 hours, so it's pretty instant when they unfreeze it.
The one thing that I'll caution is when you put a freeze on your credit, you're going to get like a 6-digit PIN number. Make sure you know where those are. Because if you do apply for credit and you need to unfreeze it, you're going to have that PIN. And I've run into a few situations where customers didn't have the PIN. And then it was a big job trying to get it unfrozen. So make sure you keep those pins, but keep them in a safe place.
Okay. Another type of identity theft that I'm going to talk about, again, there's lots of things that you need to look for to protect yourself. Medical identity theft, the Protection Bureau says that 1.5 million adults are victims of medical identity theft each year. That occurs when someone steals your personal information and your Medicare number. So be on the lookout for, you know, if you get a bill for a service or a medical procedure that you did not do, if you are contacted by a debt collector through that medical department that you didn't get service for, or if your insurance company says you've reached your limit on your medical bills, because people will steal that information from you and get procedures or prescription drugs or things like that in your name that you're now financially responsible for. So just be on the lookout for that. Another type of fraud that we see is investment fraud. We've all heard the timeless saying that if it sounds too good to be true, it probably is. If these are good words to live by, but you just want to know when good becomes too good. Advisors, financial planners, and brokers are normally honest and reputable. Here's some tips to tell the difference, though. Don't ever trust the trustworthiness by the sound of their voice. If they try to tell you to act now or before it's too late statement, that's typically a red flag. Don't ask for, don't take their verbal recommendation, have it written and put down in writing for you. Stay in charge of your money and enlist the help of a trusted third party or a friend, just like Steph said. And then always make the check payable to the actual financial institution, not to a private individual. That's another red flag to look for. All right, telephone and mail scams. This is something that we see at the branch all the time. It's the most common. Older adults are increasing targets for this scam because they use lies or deception or fear to convince you to send them money or provide your own personal information. They will be very convincing, but if something seems unusual, always check it out. Never pay to play. If you win a legitimate sweepstakes or a lottery, you're never gonna have to pay money up front. And then another one is be cautious of, if you load these prepaid debit cards for us and mail them to us, then that check will just come out of your account. That is one of the most common we see all the time. So be really careful if someone asks you to send money back, whether it's a check or through gift cards or even through a wire. We actually have a lot of people that will call you as a fear tactic and say that you have a relative or someone you know in trouble and ask them to wire money to that person. We actually had a client, unfortunately, that fell for that, and they had sent thousands of dollars because they thought their nephew was in trouble. So just be careful of stuff like that. In your packet there, you've got some handouts for me as well. So in case of emergency, what happens? Being prepared in all types of emergencies to give you peace of mind, to know that you are protected. While there is not always high-tech identity theft, people will still try to ruin your day by lifting your wallet or stealing your purse. So that handout talks to you like what to do first if that does unfortunately happen to you. And then there is a second handout that goes with that one that actually has a checklist of all of the pertinent information that you would need. There's four keys to be ready for this. Key one is to make copies of important documents, and you can even scan them to have storage and access to them. Know where to store them. So again, like Steph said, make sure you've got a safe at home or a safe deposit box or somewhere that you can get those documents, but no one else could get to them. Key three is to have the financial documents and other supplies ready to go, such as, you know, your bank statement, your checkbook, the key to your safe deposit box. And the fourth key is to make sure that you just give yourself that peace of mind. Again, set up for direct deposit, arrange for automatic bill payments, have the internet banking with the alerts, and then always review your insurance coverage as well to make sure that you are set up for, you know, home identity theft and things like that. And then lastly, just again, knowing where to keep this kind of stuff, keep an ID, copy of your ID on file too, and then credit cards, ATM, and debit cards, just so you have those numbers. If your purse does get lost or stolen, you have the number to give to the financial institution. A lot of people forget to do that, and then they'll call the company, I lost my card. Okay, what's your account number? And they're like, I have no idea. That makes it a lot harder for you to try to prove who you are to get that kind of stuff shut down. So just keep that all in a safe place. And then we know this was a lot of information to get, but again, we want to thank you guys for coming out and listening to us. Steph and I do have more in-depth presentations on all kinds of stuff, including identity theft. There's a whole one just in by itself. So if you have any questions or anything, our cards are in the little baggies that we gave you. And then you can call us or we can stay after and we can talk then. But I'm going to turn the microphone over to Mark here so he can talk about his expertise.
All right. bills, doing a lot of things actually that a power of attorney does. So that's one of the things I do in my job. You know, we'll step in if someone becomes incompetent and they had a trust, and Regent was named as the backup trustee or the successor trustee. So the advantages of the trust, it's going to avoid probate. That's one of the number one reasons that people will use it. Also, it is only difference is you've removed the name as the owner.
Oftentimes, we recommend people leave the student's name on the account for a while, though, because of their rebates or things like that. So if it's in a non-interest-bearing account, then would they still run into that same issue for tax purposes? Okay, so maybe a checking account that's not interest-bearing. We usually recommend 6 months, just because there can be rebates or refunds or things that come in. That person's name is not on the account any longer, you can't negotiate that check. Then you have to send it back to the company, have them send you a new check with your name on it, and that can just take a long time, so.
And even where we're the executor on an estate, we typically leave the deceased checking account open, like Stephanie said, for 3 months, just because in this day and age, there are automatic deposits and withdrawals going back and forth, and sometimes you can't get those stopped immediately, so we want to make sure we have an account that kind of can clear all those things.
But not the non-interest-bearing account, so it doesn't have to be reported for taxes.
Okay, have a few minutes, you can talk about current legislation or proposed legislation.
Yeah. Thank you. As Mark mentioned, my name is Kevin O'Bout. I'm a wealth advisor, and I'll be with him more over time. So I want to plug, though, I just got done freezing my father-in-law's credit because somebody opened a bank account in Arizona for him. He lives here, all right? So make sure if you run up against that you do that, because 2 weeks later, they tried to open a loan. So once they have your information, they're going to keep using it until they can, right? So plug for Courtney and Stephanie. If you do have that, make sure you do go down.
Well, and if that happens, you haven't frozen your credit, you can put an alert out on the credit bureau's meeting. If anybody ever applies for credit, your name including yourself, they contact you first to make sure that it was actually you that applied for credit. So if you have that happen, there are still steps you can take to protect yourself.
Thought I'd throw that one out there. So, tax reform. So, we heard a question about it already, right? Keep in mind, these are all proposed. What does that mean? We don't know what will go through legislation and what will not, but it is proposed. So, the very first thing that in 2022 we are proposing, or our government is proposing, is an increase in ordinary income from 39.6% to 37% in that top tax bracket. So, not a huge difference there for our top tax bracket earners. Here for our closely held businesses and our farmers, an increase in capital gains. Okay, so again, proposed for those that exceed $1 million. So think about it: if I sold a business, if I sold farmland, and it was over $1 million, my capital gains rate would increase to 43.4%. Okay. If it's over $1 million. So think about that for a second. From over 20% to 43.4%. Again, this is proposed. I read something yesterday where they're negotiating back and forth and they land at 25. We're not sure where it's going to land, but this is where it has been proposed. An increase in corporate income tax rate from 21% to 28%. Again, proposed for our businesses. So something to think about there as well. Thank you. 1031 like exchanges I will touch on, not as impactful there. Mark touched on this earlier, reduction of federal gift estate tax exemption. So right now today, each individual, if they pass, can pass on $11.7 million without that 40% estate tax, right? So if I'm a married couple, it's about $23 million, almost $24 million, right, that I can pass on. They have proposed to take that down to $3.5 million per individual. Okay, so again, if I have a lot of farmland, if I have a business in some capacity, am I planning for that? Whether or not that goes through, we'll see. However, in 2025, the current legislation does sunset, so it's going to go down to $5 million. So it is going to change. It's just a matter of, is it now or 2025? So as we think through our planning, keeping that in mind. And then the step-up basis. There's a lot of